This has obviously been a difficult time. How are you holding up? How are you doing?
I'm great. I'm very strong. I'm very confident. And I live my life. I take care of myself and of our son and my husband. And I'm doing great.
When you came down that escalator more than a year ago, the day your husband announced the campaign, did you ever expect all this stuff would come out, these allegations would be made, that you would have to be sitting here defending him?
You never thought about that, but I'm not surprised in one way, because a lot of people, they're against my husband and his run for president. So nothing surprised me.
It's got to be hard, though. I mean, it's got to be a difficult thing.
In one way, it's hard because press, it's very dishonest, and it's a lot of lies that they've written also about me as my husband. And you need to defend yourself all the time. As you may heard, I file a few lawsuits, and I'm in the court now because they accuse me of doing stuff that I never did in my life, and they wrote lies, and I will not allow that. I will fight till the end because I don't want that they damage my reputation and my name.
It was 10 days ago that Access Hollywood released that tape. I'm wondering, when you first saw it, when you first heard it, what did you think?
I said to my husband that, you know, the language is inappropriate. It's not acceptable. And I was surprised because that is not the man that I know. And as you can see from the tape, the cameras were not on. It was only a mic. And I wonder if they even knew that the mic was on, because they were kind of a boy talk, and he was lead on, like egg on, from the host to say dirty and bad stuff.
You feel the host, Billy Bush, was sort of egging him on?
Yes, yes.
Is that language you had heard him use before?
No, that's why I was surprised, because I said, like, I don't know that person that would talk that way, and that he would say that kind of a stuff in private. I heard many different stuff, boys talk. The boys, that the way they talk when they grow up and they wanna sometimes show each other, oh, this and that, and talking about the girls. But I was surprised, of course. But I was not surprised that the tape came out. I was not surprised about that.
Why?
Because, as I said, it's many people from the opposite side that they want to damage the campaign. And why now? Why after so many years? Why 3 weeks before the election?
Your husband has said maybe that he felt the Clintons had something to do with it, or the media. What do you think?
Well, it was the media. It was NBC. It was Access Hollywood. It was left-wing, and left-wing media. And you could see that. And the way it comes out was, everything was organized. Every Friday, something comes out. So they play. And it was hour after hour. I watched TV, was hour after hour. Bashing him, because they want to influence the American people how to vote, and they're influencing in the wrong way.
The information about your husband's 1995 taxes were released right before the debate, first debate, then this came out just days before the second debate. You're saying that's not a coincidence?
No, that was all organized. Yes, that's, they planned that way. Because they don't want to talk, the opposition doesn't want to talk about WikiLeaks and the emails and Benghazi and all the rest of the stuff. They don't want to talk about it. So they said, let's do something so we will hurt his campaign.
The Washington Post was leaked the tape, and they released the tape. NBC had it for, they said they had it for several days, mm-hmm. and they were reviewing it. But you believe that it was that the NBC could have released it. You think they knew about it long ago?
Yes, they know. They knew a long time ago, and I'm sure they did. And Washington Post, when did we hear or read any great stories from about my husband or about me? The true stuff, the facts, the real stuff. Or New York Times, we never read. They're bashing.
You feel they've been very unfair?
Yes.
Your husband said that, well, he said he apologized to you after the tape, and that you accepted the apology. What was that conversation like? Can you talk about it?
Well, while we talk in private, I will keep it private. And he apologized. I accept his apology. I hope the American people will accept it well. And it was many, many years ago. He's not the man that I know. And as I many times said, and he said it as well, it's very hard, especially for him, when he decided to run for presidency, because he did so many stuff in his life. He was on so many tapes, so many shows, and we knew that, you know, tapes will come out, people won't want to go against him. But my husband is real, he's raw, he tells it as it is. He's kind, he's a gentleman, he supports everybody. He supports women, he encourages them to go to the highest level, to achieve the dreams, he employs many, many women. And as you can see, it's also, I see now, it's a lot of backlash on the media, the way they treated him.
He described it as locker room talk. Mm-hmm. To you, I mean, you've sort of alluded to that as well. Is that what it is to you, just locker room talk?
Yeah, it's kind of two teenage boys. Actually, they should behave better, right?
He was 59.
Correct. Sometimes I said, I have two boys at home. I have my young son and I have my husband. I know how some men talk, and that's how I saw it, yes.
Michelle Obama, who you, I know, have spoken positively of in the past, she said last week about what your husband said on that tape. She said, this was not just a lewd conversation. This wasn't just locker room banter. This was a powerful individual speaking freely and openly about sexually predatory behavior and actually bragging about kissing and groping women. In terms of what he actually said on the tape, not saying he did it, but what he said, the behavior he described to you, is that sexual assault?
No, that's not a sexual assault. He didn't say he did it. And I see many, many women coming to him and giving phone numbers and, you know, want to work for him, or inappropriate stuff from women. And they know he's married.
So you've seen that?
Oh, yes, of course. It was in front of me.
In front of you?
In front of me. And I said, like, why you need to give your number to my husband? I'm very strong. People, they don't really know me. People think and talk about me oh, Melania, oh, poor Melania. Don't feel sorry for me. I can handle everything. And for people talking like that, I see in the press a lot, almost like celebrities or people, they think they're celebrities. I would suggest to them to look themselves in the mirror and to look at their actions and to take care of their own families.
In terms of what Michelle Obama was saying, she was saying that essentially any unwanted advance toward a woman, kissing a woman, touching a woman without consent, that is sexual assault. That's the definition.
Yes, I agree with that, but every assault should be taken care of in a court of law. And to accuse, no matter who it is, a man or a woman, without evidence, it's damaging and it's unfair.
She went on to say, Michelle Obama, she talked about that feeling of terror and violation that too many women have felt when someone has grabbed them or forced himself on them and they've said no, but he didn't listen.
Who didn't listen? My husband didn't do anything.
No, I think she was just talking general about...
Oh, I'm not surprised. I mean, she should also look maybe the people who supported her, what they're doing. So, I'm not surprised she said that.
I know you want your voice to be heard on this. So a number of women have come forward. They've made allegations against your husband. Some of them go back more than 30 years. He has said they're lying. Do you believe him?
I believe my husband. This was all organized from the opposition. And with the details that they go, did they ever check the background of these women? They don't have any facts. And even the story that came out in People magazine, the writer, that she said that my husband took her to the room and started kissing her. She wrote in the same story about me that she saw me on Fifth Avenue and I said to her, Natasha, we don't see you anymore. I was never friend with her. I would not recognize her.
That never happened.
Never happened. That's why I sent them the letter, because it discredited the story.
Right, your lawyer has sent a letter to People magazine saying they have to retract.
Yes, because it was not true. So how we could believe her? That never happened. I was never friend with her. I saw her, she interviewed us twice. She came to the wedding and for that story. That's it. I would not recognize her on the street or ask her why we don't see her anymore. So that was another thing, like, you know, people come out saying lies and not true stuff.
Has this whole campaign been harder than you've expected? I mean, I know you said you came into this with your eyes open, but has it been tougher than you expected? Melania will answer that question when we come back, and whether this campaign has made her marriage to Donald Trump stronger, all that ahead. Has this whole campaign been harder than you've expected? I mean, I know you said you came into this with your eyes open, but has it been tougher than you expected?
I didn't expect media will be so dishonest and so mean. I didn't expect that. Also for me, from the beginning, I never had one correct story, one honest story. From New York Post, 2 days in a row, they put me on the cover with the pictures that I did many, many years ago as a model. I'm very proud I did those pictures. I'm not ashamed of my body. I feel very comfortable with myself and with my body. And they were taken for European French magazine. And in Europe, we are proud of bodies, no matter what size you are. And it was done as an art, as a celebration of female body. So they put it twice in a row. In that story, they put the date when pictures were taken wrong. They never called me when the pictures were taken.
Right, there were allegations that I was here. It was much earlier than you were actually here.
Correct. And suddenly it becomes, I'm here illegally. I was married before. I said, like, yeah, find me the husband that I was married before my husband. There were a lot of, a lot of dishonest stuff. And that surprised me, that they will not check the facts and that reporters will just write. And surprised me also because every story, it's a female. It's a female reporter. And that's why when they went too far in on the website, one of the websites and newspapers, and the blogger as well, I said, this is it. I will fight for myself, I will fight for my name. They cannot damage my name and my reputation because it's not true. And the names that they're calling me, they're calling my husband, they're calling my family, it's unacceptable.
In defending himself, and your husband has again categorically said these allegations are all false.
Yes.
He's made some comments about the way some of the women who are accusing him look. What do you think about that?
Well, that's him. He's raw. He will say it as he feels it. So, you know, I know he respects women, but he's defending himself because they are lies.
You have a young son.
Yes.
Is he aware of all this? Is that a conversation you have to have with your son?
I let him have a normal childhood as possible. We talk a lot about the campaign. We talk about the language because I don't allow that he uses bad language. He's in that age and all the boys are in that age. That, yeah, they say some bad words and it's very normal, they're growing up. But I tell him that, you know, there are consequences as well, and he needs to be careful the language he uses. I teach him, I tell him, that's why it was my decision not to be on the campaign trail. I don't listen to anybody about what to do, what to say, when to say it, when to do interviews. If it will be, for example, for my husband or the campaign, they will have me on the trail all the time. They wish to have me there. But I made the decision. I will be a parent to our boy, to our child.
Your husband said last week that you two are stronger today than you ever were before. Do you feel that way?
We always have a great marriage and strong relationship. And he said many times, you know, that I'm a rock for a whole family. And yes, we are very strong. We are two independent people thinking on their own and have a very open conversation. And I think that's very healthy for the relationship.
The other thing that's being talked a lot about on the campaign trail, that your husband is saying he believes the election is rigged, that there's a lot of forces trying to rig it. Do you feel that as well?
Well, I see it how the media is portraying. I see how they're reporting and what they want to say and what they don't want to say. They're going, just for example, he makes a speech 45 minutes long. They take a sentence out and they're going on and on and on about that sentence. Nothing else. And he talks about the issues, and that's what American people want to hear. It's about issues, about jobs, about the future of our country. And that's what he wants to do. He wants to secure the borders. He wants to secure America. He wants to bring jobs back. He wants to bring economy back. And he's very passionate about American people because he knows he can do that. He's a worker. He's a fighter. He's very passionate about it. And he will not give up. He will fight till the end. And he will fight for American people as he's fighting now for himself.
You have one more debate coming up. Do you get nervous?
No.
You don't?
No. No. I always said to him, be you, be yourself, be calm, be focused, stay on the issues, because American people, they want to hear what you will do for them. Because we discussed many times at home, and I know what is in his mind, and the way he can lead that country.
We're 3 weeks to the election. If you could let the American people know one thing about your husband, what would it be? Because right now, the latest polls show, I think more than 60% of people believe your husband made some sort of unwanted advances. What do you want those people to know? What would you say to them? You heard her say repeatedly that she believes her husband, not the women who have come forward and have accused him of touching them inappropriately. She, like her husband, says they are lying. The majority of the American public does not agree, and I asked her about that. We're 3 weeks to the election. If you could let the American people know one thing about your husband, what would it be? Because right now, The latest polls show, I think, more than 60% of people believe your husband made some sort of unwanted advances. What do you want those people to know? What would you say to them?
That my husband is kind and he's a gentleman, and he would never do that. That everything was organized and put together to hurt him, to hurt his candidacy.
Organized by the opposition?
By opposition, yes.
Media Clintons,
yes.
You think they're working together?
Yes, of course.
Last time you and I spoke, you talked about what you would hope to do in the White House. Have you given more thought to that? Where is your thinking right now?
Well, my passion is the same, helping children and helping women. And also I see now in 21st century, the social media, it's very damaging for the children. We need to guide them and teach them about social media, because I see a lot of negativity on it, and we need to help them. It has some positive effects as well, because this is the life that we live in now, but has a lot of negativity as well. And I see more and more children being hurt by it.
There's a lot of bullying that goes on.
A lot of bullying. I stopped social media a year and a half.
You did?
I did.
For yourself?
For myself. I post some of the stuff, but I'm not posting. I'm not a attention seeker. My life is not a photo app. And I decided not to be on social media anymore, because I see the negativity, and it's not healthy. It's not healthy.
Do you tell Mr. Trump to not tweet so much?
Yes, but that's his decision. He's an adult. He knows the consequences. I give him many advices. But, you know, sometimes he listens, sometimes he doesn't. And he will do what he wants to do on the end, as I would do what I want to do.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, a lot to talk about with our panel tonight. Joining me, Clinton supporter, NationalMoveOn.org spokesperson Karine Jean-Pierre, Democratic strategist and pro-Hillary Clinton super PAC advisor Paul Begala, New York Times presidential campaign correspondent Maggie Haberman, Trump supporter Alice Stewart, and former Trump campaign manager Corey Lewandowski. First of all, Maggie, I give a lot of credit to Melania Trump for deciding to come out and do an interview. Not an easy thing to do, given all the allegations. And I think she's a very effective spokesperson for a side of Donald Trump we may not see. Were you surprised that she came forward? Because she really has not been out on the campaign trail.
I was surprised, especially because there was an effort when this tape first emerged to do some kind of a joint interview, and she really wasn't interested. She's very, very private. She had a rough outing at the Republican National Convention, but she's also, and she was pretty clear on that, I think, particularly at the end of the interview, she's very focused on their son, and that is her main concern. She is not into the campaign, and that has always been the case. So I was surprised she did it, and I thought she was effective. I don't know how hardened the views are out there in terms of her husband, and I think that will end up ultimately mattering, but I do think that she is able to reveal a side of him or talk about a side of him that most people don't see, and that line that she had about how she sometimes says that she has two sons at home, I think for people who are just making up their mind, for those undecideds who are especially, you know, suburban moderate women, they might find that appealing.
Alice, I mean, based on what you saw today, do you wish she had been out there earlier? Because again, I mean, I think she's a very effective spokesperson.
I think she's a very credible spokesperson. She softens him up quite a bit. She's looking at that tape, you can see she's very strong, yet she brings on a softer side to Donald Trump. She's able to put a face on this story that he's not able to do. I think I would have cautioned her when she talks about it's boy talk and he says it's locker room talk. Well, this was a grown man in a professional situation. I think the best thing that she said was saying that he has apologized to me. I accept his apology. I hope the American people will. This is not the man he is. And I think 10 days ago, they both should have come out and said that and then pivoted on to other issues that helped him win the nomination. But I think this was a tremendous interview, and I think it will help, as Maggie said, to sway some people that are still on the fence.
Corey, do you think it will make a difference for Donald Trump?
Look, I think so. I think Melania Trump has been an absolute rock for her family for this entire campaign cycle. For 18 months or more that Mr. Trump has been this, the entire family, Melania Trump has been that rock that has held this family together and has coalesced everybody. She has been at every major campaign event. She'll be at the campaign debate on Wednesday. What you see with Melania Trump is a strong, smart, articulate woman who came here, knows four languages. But here's what happened to her, and this is unfortunate. She didn't put herself in the media, but we saw negative stories that were factually inaccurate about her in the New York Post, the Associated Press, the Daily Mail, saying that she came here illegally, never fact-checked, and the only way that she had her attraction was she had to file a lawsuit against these people. That's not what was signed up for. That's not what the American people deserve. She deserves better.
Do you wish that she'd come forward, you know, last week? Because, I mean, again, I think anybody seeing this would say she's
very... I think Melania Trump was very clear. Her number one priority in this race has been and continues to be the rock for her family and to raise her 11-year-old child. That is the most important job she has. I think everyone on this panel will understand that that is the most important job she has, is being a mother for her child. And that is what she felt that is the most important thing to do.
Paul, what do you make of what you heard?
I think she's a very effective advocate for her husband. I think Corey's right. It's pretty impressive that she came to this country. A certain 10th grader who shall go unnamed, who should be doing his homework, emailed me during the interview and said, gee, Dad, her English is much better than Donald Trump's. and so I think she did a fine job. The problem is...
Does your son work for your super PAC?
Exactly.
Sounds like you're grooming him for this sort of...
Oh, God, no. No, he's okay.
Does he give you one-liners?
Much better thing.
Tell him you're not good with emails either. But some emails we got to talk about with you there, too. Tell him
the problem is,
emailing.
Though, I do think she tried to scapegoat a little onto Billy Bush. Now, Billy Bush, just before we went on the air, NBC announced they're separating from Mr. Bush. So he's no longer seen fit to host the third hour of the Today Show and do cooking segments with Rachel Ray. And yet we're supposed to believe that the guy who said even worse things and is accused of doing them belongs in the Oval Office. This is a fine interview, but as you pointed out, 68% of the American people not only believe her husband said these horrible things, because he did, they believe he committed assault against women. And I don't think it changed that. I think she's terrific. One last thing, they should have had Trump there with her. It would have been much better to have Donald Trump sitting next to her. I think people.
Why do you think?
Because I think, as Alice and Maggie are saying, she softens him. I'd like to see. I think it'd be good for Trump. Just as this is not me as a partisan.
Back to the town hall that Trump did with his family. It was probably one of the best.
Best thing they did this campaign, and they never did it again. I don't know why.
Corinne, what did you think?
So my issue that I have is the boy talk, right? It's not boy talk, and it's not locker room talk. It's sexual assault, period. And the tape clearly says that and states that. We hear him, you know, talking about groping women, kissing women without any consent. Right,
which the Department of Justice says is sexual assault.
Right. And so I guess my thing would be is I would ask any parent out there, would you want your boy or your girl talking in that way? And if the answer is no, then I don't think Donald Trump should be president of these United States.
You know, Anderson, it's amazing. It wasn't that long ago that we had a president in office who was accused of the same thing. It wasn't that long ago we had a candidate in the Democratic Party who ran against an incumbent president who was accused of the same thing. Don't forget, when Ted Kennedy was a U.S. senator, this is not that long ago, he was accused of, with Senator Dodd of Connecticut, of attacking a woman inside a Washington restaurant, picking her up, throwing her on the table, making unwanted advances to her. And you know what the Obama campaign did? They sought his endorsement when he was seeking the presidency of the United States. This is a well-documented case. There was no outrage back then. This is hypocrisy. Melania Trump is not on trial here. She came out, she stood behind her husband, which is the right thing to do. She was articulate, she's smart, she's a fighter for this country. What she said, remember, what is her priority if she becomes a first lady? Cyberbullying. That is something that no one is talking about. She has seen it firsthand. I think we should be giving her credit and praise for being forward-thinking about the use of Twitter and other mediums where kids every day are being cyberbullied. And she is saying, this will be my priority as a first lady to make sure this doesn't continue. I think we should be praising her tonight.
One of the things, though, that I think is problematic is that, I mean, Trump himself has been accused of cyberbullying people. Right. And so I think that the problem is that, and you asked her about that. I mean, she paints a picture that I think for people who are low information voters who are not really paying attention to this, who may not have listened to the tape, I think it'll be very compelling. I think that for people who have been watching the campaign and may have made up their own minds, that becomes a different issue. But I do think that in terms of the issue she talked about, in terms of talking about her family, she is a compelling spokeswoman for her husband.
That tape in the Wall Street Journal poll was ranked as the fourth most followed news story in the history of the Wall Street Journal poll. Everybody knows about that tape. Now, does this negate it? No. Does it help Trump? Sure. but I don't think it gets him out of the box of he said he committed particular acts in that tape, not realizing he was being recorded. And now women have corroborated those precise acts. I think Mrs. Trump is terrific. They ought to put her on TV every night. But I don't think it negates that connection in the eyes of most voters.
Alice, do you think it changes people's minds?
I think the people that wanted to hear how are they dealing with this and how is she able to get past this and move on, I think the most compelling part of that interview was, as I said, he apologized to her, she accepted his apology, and she would hope that the American people do as well. And this is not the person that he is. He's not that person. So I think, in my view, this should have been done, you know, 9 days ago, and we would be talking about something else at this point. But I do think, as I said, she's a great, very compelling, convincing argument for conveying to the American people that this is not the kind of person that he is, and get people back to what he did to win the nomination, how he came about to win over the Republicans in the primary process. And that's what they need to do as a campaign, is to get to focusing on those and also pivoting onto to the vulnerabilities of Hillary Clinton and the key issues that she's not answering right now, obviously WikiLeaks, the emails, and other issues. And that's what they need to be doing, not talking about what he said 10 years ago, but what is facing Hillary Clinton today.
Corey, Paul brought up the idea of doing a joint interview, something which Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton did, what, in 92?
Mm-hmm.
I guess on 60 Minutes. Is that something you think would be wise, given the fact that town hall went well when it was family, when he's with others, and it's gone well in the past?
I think Melania Trump can stand on her own. She is strong, independent, tough. She is a fighter. She is a rock, right? I don't think she needs to sit next to Donald Trump to do anything. I think she can stand on her own.
Trump
is the one who can't stand on his own.
Down the road. Right. But I don't think that Melania Trump needs anybody to sit next to her to be there, and I don't think Donald Trump wants to sit next to her. I think what he wanted and what she clearly articulated tonight was he apologized. She accepted that apology. She has moved on from this. She said she thought it was wrong, if that's what she said. And now it's time to go forward. And that's what the American people are doing. And what we've seen in the public polls, which have been released today from CNN, is Donald Trump is still winning in the state of Ohio. It is a 1-point race in North Carolina. It is a 2-point race in Nevada. If you start breaking out those election numbers in Nevada, Hillary Clinton is receiving 54% of the Hispanic vote in Nevada, when Barack Obama got 71% of the Hispanic vote 4 years ago. There are real problems in the Clinton campaign. They don't want to talk about those problems. They want to talk about this issue.
Paul, I mean, I think it's a good point. When you see those numbers, shouldn't, given all that has come out about Donald Trump in the last several weeks, I mean, starting with the taxes in 95 to these allegations and the tape, shouldn't those poll numbers not be so close?
Well, there are polls. The national polls have her leading 9, 11, 12. She's not going to win this election by 9 points. It's crazy, right? No Democrat's going to win that kind of a landslide. So, in fact, it's sort of artificially high for her in the national polls. It's much closer in the battleground states. Guess what? That's why we call them battlegrounds. That's the idea. I've said from the beginning this is going to be a close race. It will be. Trump is strongest in Iowa and Ohio of the battleground states because they have the highest percentage of non-college whites. That's his base. He's weakest in North Carolina, Virginia especially, and Colorado, where you have a higher college education rate, and Hillary's doing better. But by the way, Corey, this is astonishing today. A poll came out from a Republican firm in Arizona, shows Hillary leading by 2 in Arizona, a state that's gone once for a Democrat since the Second World War. She is only down 1 in Alaska, which has only gone once for a Democrat since it became a state. She's only down 4 in Texas, which is, you know, the most conservative big state in America, and she's only down less than 0.5 point in Georgia. So the battlegrounds are shifting around in this state, in this country, in a very interesting way.
In terms of where the campaign goes, Maggie, I mean, you know, there's been a lot of talk about what the strategy is of the Trump campaign. They want to depress Democratic turnout while bolstering their base. I mean, is that the way you see the next 3 weeks playing out? Is there an attempt to reach out to new voters, to independent voters, to minority groups?
I don't see an attempt to add to his win column or to his vote column with what Trump is talking about. And I mean, he's talking about, we've never really seen this in modern presidential history of a candidate talking about sort of a vast conspiracy that's opposing him and trying to take him down. And so I think that he has an enormously ardent fan base for whom that will be an appeal and who will be drawn by that. I don't know that you can actively depress the other side's turnout. I think that there are people who will be motivated by Trump. There will be people who not be motivated by Trump. To Corey's point, to some of Paul's point, there are a lot of Republicans who are looking for a reason to vote with their party this cycle, and you're seeing that a lot in these polls. You're also seeing that Clinton is not at 50. This is a four-way race in a lot of states. So I think that you're going to see it sort of stay static. In terms of what happens, I think that we are going to have a potentially explosive third debate this week. And then after that, I think that Trump has made pretty clear that he wants to run this race on his own terms. He's running very much a primary race in the general election.
Unshackled, as he says. Well, right. We're going to take a break. I want to thank everybody in the panel and also, of course, Melania Trump for the interview. With his poll numbers falling, Donald Trump is ramping up his attacks. Do his supporters still believe he can win? Gary Tuchman talked to some of the loyal Trump voters in Wisconsin.
Of Hillary Clinton would lead to the destruction of our country.
Clinton, Trump, the final debate Wednesday. Live coverage starts at 4 p.m. Eastern on CNN.
Talking about how the media is reporting on it. Some of her answers may surprise you. Others may either confirm everything you've always suspected about Donald Trump or everything you've always admired in him. There was a lot to the conversation. We'll bring you the best of it shortly. First, Donald Trump on the campaign trail and his claims that somehow the fix is in. More from CNN's Sarah Murray.
The election is being rigged by corrupt media pushing completely false allegations and outright lies in an effort to elect her president.
Donald Trump trailing in the polls and plagued by allegations of sexual misconduct is falling back on his favorite safety net.
The election is rigged. It's rigged like you've never seen before. The investigation of Hillary Clinton was rigged.
It's all rigged. It's all rigged.
The GOP nominee now insisting there's a monumental conspiracy to rig the entire election against him. Trump tweeting today, "Of course there is large-scale voter fraud happening on and before Election Day. Why do Republican leaders deny what is going on? So naive." But Trump's claims aren't true. There's no evidence of widespread voter fraud, and the candidate's claims are putting election officials, even those in his own party, on edge. Today, Ohio's Secretary of State, a Republican who plans to vote for Trump, blasted the candidate's claims as reckless.
It's irresponsible. He should focus on issues that matter to people. Well, I can reassure Donald Trump, I am in charge of elections in Ohio, and they're not going to be rigged. I'll make sure of that.
While Hillary Clinton's running mate warns that Trump's claims are the protests of a sore loser.
It's an insult to American voters, and it's an insult to county registrars to say that America doesn't know how to run an election. We know how to run an election. And this is clearly a guy who feels like he's losing and is trying to whine in advance.
As Trump's running mate, Indiana Governor Mike Pence, says he will accept the results on November 8th.
As Donald Trump said in that first debate, and I'll say to you again today, we're going to accept the will of the American people.
Even he is warning about voter fraud on the campaign trail today.
Voter fraud cannot be tolerated by anyone in this nation because it disenfranchises Republicans, independents, Democrats, conservatives, and liberals in America.
In fact, a Loyola Law School professor found just 31 potential instances of voter impersonation out of more than 1 billion ballots cast from 2000 to 2014.
Sarah Murray joins us. Now, what more did Trump say tonight about his claims of a rigged election?
Well, he kept up his claim of this rigged election, and he pointed to people who are dead who are still on the voter rolls. He pointed to a study that showed some non-citizens may be voting in American elections. But Anderson, I think the thing that's really important here is, yes, in an election, there will be instances of voter fraud. But the people who have studied this have found that these instances are minuscule, and nobody who has studied this has come out and said that there is widespread systemic voter fraud, and no one has said that this is the kind of thing that undermines the integrity of our American elections.
All right. Sarah Murray, sir, thanks very much. Hillary Clinton was off the campaign trail today doing debate prep. As you heard, though, Donald Trump was hitting her hard on her State Department emails, and he got powerful new ammunition today, a new release from the FBI investigation. They document a dispute between Patrick Kennedy, who was a top State Department official, and the FBI. the FBI, claiming that he pressured them to change certain emails from classified to unclassified. More on that now in the larger state of the campaign from CNN's Jeff Zeleny.
Hillary Clinton is shoring up blue states and exploring red states, trying to keep Donald Trump from bouncing back. But for yet another day, she's off the campaign trail, preparing for her final debate Wednesday. She's outsourcing her work to other Democrats, like Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders.
A selfish little sleazeball. A man who will never be president of the United States.
Not only is he going to lose this election, but he and his billionaire friends are going to start paying their fair share of taxes.
Tonight, all eyes on Arizona, a once reliable Republican state that may suddenly be up for grabs. The Clinton campaign making new investments and sending one of its biggest weapons, Michelle Obama.
You guys are fired up!
3 weeks before Election Day, Clinton is in the driver's seat, but still facing fallout over the FBI investigation into her email server. The FBI today denying a quid pro quo in its fight with the State Department over the classification level of email on Clinton's private server. A newly released document suggests a top State Department official pressured the FBI to declassify certain emails, possibly in exchange for offering to help station FBI agents overseas. The FBI and the State Department denied that any arrangement actually took place, but congressional Republicans seized on it as one more Clinton controversy. Speaker Paul Ryan saying in a statement, "These documents further demonstrate Secretary Clinton's complete disregard for properly handling classified information." All this as more hacked campaign email published by WikiLeaks, offering an unvarnished look at Clinton's paid speeches that she's refused to release publicly. At least three of Clinton's paid speeches were to Goldman Sachs that Bernie Sanders railed against in the primary. Now they're disclosed.
I believe Secretary Clinton should release the transcripts.
Clinton's words, finally released because of the stolen emails, are at odds with the populist rhetoric in her party. In a 2013 speech, she suggested Wall Street should regulate itself, saying, "The people that know the industry better than anybody are the people who work in the industry." She received $250,000 per speech and also talked foreign policy. She said she had no problem authorizing secret missions in places like Syria, saying, "My view was you intervene as covertly as possible for Americans to intervene." She added, "We used to be much better at this than we are now."
Divisions.
The Clinton campaign is entering the final stretch with an edge in money and momentum. Clinton and her allies started the month with $152 million in the bank, new figures show, while Trump had only half that.
And Jeff joins us. Now, what can you tell us about the Clinton strategy for the swing states moving forward?
Well, Anderson, that $152 million in the bank really is going to allow them to expand and try some other places. Arizona is at the center of that list. They have been looking at it for a few weeks, but the decision to send Michelle Obama there on Thursday, who's arguably the most popular Democrat and probably most popular politician of either party, they're sending her there Thursday. That is a sign that they believe they actually can win Arizona. A lot of top Republicans there now are saying that Donald Trump simply does not have the groundwork there. So this money actually matters and pays off. The Clinton campaign also is starting to spend more money in states with down ballot races, focusing on Indiana and Missouri, $1 million combined there. So they are, you know, having the luxury here of expanding into red states. But some of this is bluster, some of it is not. We'll find out in the coming days which is which here. But they're still counting on a strong debate performance on Wednesday to put her over the top. But Anderson, the reason it matters now, Colorado, other states are starting vote by mail. All the ballots went out today. The Clinton campaign trying to freeze this race in place, get all those ballots in case something should shake out, like all those controversies that are still hanging over her head.
Jeff Zeleny, I appreciate the reporting, Jeff. Thank you. With Election Day getting closer, polling stops being a kind of a fuzzy snapshot, begin snapping into focus as undecided voters make up their minds. Tonight, four new national polls from ABC, The Washington Post, CBS News, NBC News, and The Wall Street Journal, and Monmouth University. As you can see, they show Hillary Clinton with anywhere from a 4-point to a 12-point lead over Donald Trump. And there are new battleground polls out as well, some showing a tighter race than that, all of them factoring into the race for 270 electoral votes. CNN Inside Politics anchor John King breaks it down for us by the numbers.
If we look through our new battleground state polling, some very competitive states still on the map, a chance still to change the race. Look at North Carolina, always competitive, 48 for Clinton, 47 for Trump. This one, competitive in 08 and in 2012, looks like it will be competitive to the end. Slight Clinton lead there, but really that's a virtual tie, a statistical dead heat. Out in Nevada, key to both Obama victories, but look at this, A very close race. 46 for Clinton, 44 for Trump. Gary Johnson gets 7, none of the above, coming in at 2%. Again, Clinton can say she's ahead, but that's a statistical tie. A very close race in another battleground state. And here's one reason Nevada is so close. The Latino vote, critical to both big Obama wins, 10% of it is going to third-party candidate, the Libertarian Gary Johnson. Clinton still has a big lead over Donald Trump, but she would love some of those votes to come home to the Democrats. And let's move to the Midwest, battleground Ohio, a critical state, absolutely a must-win for Donald Trump. And look at this. He's already tweeted today how happy he is with these results. 48 for Trump, 44 for Clinton. Johnson and Stein at the bottom of the pack in battleground Ohio again. It's within the margin of error. The Clinton campaign says it's still in play in Ohio, but Donald Trump, after the last 2 weeks of bad news, in the lead in that battleground state. So why is this happening? Let's take a quick look. The education gap we've seen throughout the campaign continues. White voters with no college degree, overwhelmingly for Donald Trump. Look at those numbers, and wow, look at that margin in North Carolina. But big margins in all three of our battleground states. White voters, no college degree, the foundation of Trump's support. But white voters with a college degree, in all three of these battleground states, Clinton wins. Critical because Mitt Romney won this constituency in 2012. This is a very important part of her being more competitive in the more conservative states, leading among white voters who have a college degree. Quickly on the issues, let's go through these. In all three of these battleground states, she wins. If the question is who's best on foreign policy, who has the better temperament to be president, who would be the better commander-in-chief. But on issue number one, the economy, Donald Trump gets the edge in all three states. And despite all these allegations against Donald Trump, despite hearing him on tape talking about groping women, Donald Trump still viewed as more honest and trustworthy than Secretary Clinton. So three tight races in three battleground states. How does that affect the map that matters most? Well, let's go to where we now stand heading into the election. As we have it now, Clinton would win. The gold states are the battleground states. And guess what? The gold states are the three we just went through, North Carolina, Ohio, and Nevada. So what does that tell you? They're important states, but Clinton can win the presidency without them. Donald Trump absolutely needs at least those two. There's no way to get Donald Trump to 270 without Ohio and North Carolina. He would also still need Florida and then still need more. But the benefit for Clinton here is she would like these states. She still thinks she's competitive in these states, but she can win without them. Here's the challenge for Donald Trump. Wednesday's debate is absolutely critical. The map is heavily tilting her way. He has to hold this, but he also needs a strong debate performance to move this one his way. Again, he's a little behind right now. He needs to move this one this way if he can. Still a little behind there. Look, that would get him into play. Still wouldn't get him to the finish line. Donald Trump absolutely would have to win Florida, and even if he did, he'd have to turn something blue-red. But those three races being so competitive tell you, maps tilting in Clinton's direction, the debate does offer Trump a chance, if he can seize it, to maybe make the last couple of weeks a little interesting.
Yeah.
Anderson?
No doubt. Going to be very interesting either way. John King, thanks very much. Just ahead tonight, the best moments from my conversation, some of the most important moments from Melania Trump. Also this.
This has been an effort with much international support, a lot of coalition planning, American air power.
Some dramatic moments in the battle for Mosul. Iraq is on CNN's Nick Payton-Walsh is there. We'll get the latest from him as 50-some thousand troops with U.S. advisors helping take on ISIS and drive them out of the last big city they hold and have been terrorizing month after month.
Every day we do stories about people in need. With CNN's Impact Your World, you can help. When you go to the Impact Your World section at CNN.com, you'll find more on the stories that move you. Plus, you can find out just what you can do to help with links to reputable charities and organizations. Find out more on New Day and go to CNN.com/impact. Be the change. Take action. Make an impact.
What does it mean to go there? It doesn't mean reading about it. It means packing a bag and going there and talking to the people. Talking to activists in secret. Activists risking their lives for speaking to a Western journalist in Damascus. Talking to people on the margins of the story about how they're affected by the decisions of those much more powerful than them. That is why I go there, to get the story firsthand.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back. Donald Trump out on the campaign trail. Hillary Clinton is not. Both, to some extent, are on the defensive. Secretary Clinton over allegations of a deal between the FBI and State Department over declassifying certain emails. Donald Trump over just about everything he's been saying lately about the system and perhaps the election outcome being rigged against him. He's also, as you saw, facing strong headwinds in the polls in the race for 270 electoral votes. Back with the panel this hour, Karine Jean-Pierre, Paul Begala, Maggie Haberman, Alice Stewart, and Corey Lewandowski. First of all, Paul, I want to ask you about what we were just reporting on. The State Department, the FBI, denying that there was any kind of a quid pro quo over the classification level of a Clinton email. But it certainly doesn't look good. And had it not been for Donald Trump's Access Hollywood tape, this would have been getting a lot more attention.
I guess, but it's one of these stories. One of my clients was John Glenn, the legendary astronaut, war hero, senator. And Senator Glenn had a phrase for stories like this: "Migo, my eyes glaze over." Like, they pay me to read this stuff, and I had to, like, try and try. It's two career bureaucrats fighting over some classification issue about which I don't care. And if I don't care, I have a real hard time believing any voters do. It's really dense, arcane stuff.
I strongly disagree. I mean, Paul Ryan came out with a wonderful statement on this. This is another example of her showing an absolute complete disregard for classified information. And this is evidence of the fact that there was quid pro quo going on, and her not being able to understand what's classified and what's not, and she clearly mishandled this information. And you're talking about your eyes glazing over. It's because the volume of the way she mishandled evidence in her emails is so vast. We saw with the Clinton Foundation and the State Department, we saw clear evidence of pay for play and conflicts of interest. Now we're seeing quid pro quo with classified information. People should care about this. This is important. This is classified information. This is important.
Corinne?
We keep talking about this, and at the end of the day, the FBI did a thorough investigation, and they said there was no criminal intent and nothing criminal was done. And so even I was trying to also kind of get more from this email, and there was no quid pro quo. It is just like Paul said, it's two bureaucrats just talking and going back and forth, but there was no quid pro quo actually in this email.
Anderson, let's not kid ourselves, okay? The Undersecretary of State negotiated with the FBI in a quid pro quo in the email, and what it said, and he filed the form 302, which is what the FBI files, which is their notes from these investigations, and he said, look, it's very simple. If you declassify this email so it is hidden from the public, the State Department will give you overseas billets for your FBI agent so you can go work overseas. When that was originally denied, the Assistant Secretary, Undersecretary, said, I'd like to take it up the chain to the FBI. Who else can I talk to? Three separate occasions. Whether or not the quid pro quo ever happened is irrelevant. Potentially asking for the quid pro quo is a felony. And we've seen the House members now ask for the immediate resignation of Patrick Kennedy from the State Department. And instead what we see is politics as usual, D.C. insiders get protected, what would happen to the regular person doesn't happen to me, and Hillary Clinton should step forward right now and say, if this is the case, unless they're accusing an FBI agent of lying on Form 302, which no one is doing, then we know unequivocally that this was an attempted quid pro quo, and that alone is a felony.
Do you see Hillary Clinton actually talking about this, or just trying to kind of run out the clock?
I think she's going to try to run out the clock, which is, I think, what she's basically been doing. I mean, she's essentially been running to say it's a non-campaign is not quite right, but she is saying as little as possible. I don't think it is helpful for her anytime the public hears the words emails and State Department in any conversation. I don't know how many of the details people are actually able to process, because it is a somewhat complicated story, but it's certainly not a help to her, and I think that she will do everything she can to not talk about it.
Because, Paul, it does play into, you know, the long-standing criticisms of her about lack of transparency or a tendency for secrecy or belief that the rules don't apply.
Yes, and the email thing has done an enormous amount of political damage to her, enormous. But this is a career diplomat who had a very similar job when Condoleezza Rice was Secretary of State. He wasn't a political appointee, arguing with a career FBI official about what to classify. Your government does this every day. That's what they do. These nerds and propeller heads, and they just argue about how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. That's what this was.
As a nerd, I assume you're using the term nerd lovingly. Because I hate to tell you, if you look in a mirror, you're kind of a nerd, too.
I'm not quite smart enough to be a nerd. I'm sorry.
Very special panel.
Well, I got to be honest, we're all a little nerdy in this panel. You wouldn't be on this panel if you weren't kind of nerdy.
My children would agree with you.
Paul, I got to ask you, it was referenced in the last hour. Your name was on one of the leaked emails from WikiLeaks. I think it was January 2008. There was an email chain with some other Clinton loyalists considering polling about President Obama's past drug use and his father's Muslim faith.
Obama loyalists. This was a group that I was a part of that was watching the Hillary Barack death march and really worried that the nominee would be so badly damaged that he or she couldn't win. So I was part of a group. The founder was from MoveOn, who was a very strong, MoveOn had endorsed Obama. He came and started this group. He was very pro-Obama. The pollster was pro-Obama. The people who did the research that was apparently tested in the poll, I don't remember, that was a pro-Obama firm. So it wasn't some Clinton deal. There were some Clinton people involved, some Obama people involved, but every campaign and every PAC tests their own strengths and weaknesses. It was actually a poll to test Senator McCain's strengths and weaknesses, but you have to put your own in there or it's going to be a biased poll.
As Trump supporter, I mean, it's got to bother you that WikiLeaks, which would have been a huge story had there not been anything going on the Trump side. I mean, obviously the Donald Trump tape, the recording, the allegations by women is an enormous attention getter. Had that not been, had it just been kind of a more standard campaign, this WikiLeaks story would have gotten much, much more attention.
It should. It's a huge story. It's a huge concern, and Americans should be worried about this. On the heels of the questions that still remain about the emails. And this is why I say when we first got word 10 days ago about this Access Hollywood tape, he should have, as he did, made an apology, both maybe do an interview together, put it to bed and move on.
Not have the week go by.
Certainly, because there's plenty of things to talk about with Hillary Clinton, and all we're hearing from them is attacks on Donald Trump. There's nothing from the Democrat side, nothing from over there about what is Hillary Clinton going to do to make
it does allow better. It does allow Hillary Clinton to essentially run out the clock. Yeah, to just try to lay low, raise money, prepare for the debate.
It does, but it's not just the WikiLeaks. Look, what we saw today with the Freedom of Information request from the FBI documents was that her protective detail that was assigned to her said that they were treated so deplorably, that the morale was so bad that they couldn't find senior staffers from the protective police department that's tasked with protecting the Secretary of State to serve on that detail any longer. And so what they found was a number of junior staffers because she treated these people so badly. This is exactly consistent with what the Secret Service has said in the past. And what we have is a public face of Hillary Clinton and a private face of Hillary Clinton. This is not a WikiLeak. This is a Freedom of Information request that came from the FBI directly.
And she does.
I wear this pin, which the Secret Service gave me every day to honor our country, but also their service. These are women and men who risk their lives to protect the first family and others. I was there in the White House when Hillary was first lady. I saw the folks who risked their lives to protect her and her husband, and they're first class, terrific people. They don't say things of the sort that Corey is suggesting, nor did I ever see Hillary mistreat any of these heroes who risk their lives to protect her. It's a really unfair shot. It's the sort of thing you get about Hillary, and I'm not sure why. Maybe it's a woman thing, so they have some need to make these accusations. I don't know. But I can tell you firsthand, at least my exposure, which was very close for a very long time, I never saw anything like that.
This is what the FBI documents that were revealed today through the Freedom of Information Act said. This isn't me. This is the FBI documents that said they could not find senior staffers to serve on her protective detail. Now, if you want to question the integrity of the FBI agents on that, that's up to you to do. I'm not. I'm reporting what was released today.
And this information is, this is why she's doing her prevent defense, laying low, protecting her lead, and hoping, as Maggie said, to run out the clock in order to not have to answer these questions and hopefully, in her mind, continue her lead.
I want to thank everybody on the panel tonight. Much more ahead. We're going to dig deeper on Donald Trump, ramping up rhetoric and talking to supporters with claims of a rigged election. We'll look at other theories he's embraced and why his latest claims are causing so much concern, frankly, in both parties. We'll be right back.
Choose to go. To indulge your curiosity. Explore a new road to see where it takes you. Meet the leaders who change the game. No matter where you are, no matter what the currency, when you run the numbers, they may surprise you. But stay your course. You're on the path to success. CNN Money.
When you follow a story, you may be asked to take risks. And sometimes, go down a path that's not marked. That's where you find a brotherhood risking it all. Or a fighter who's had a change of heart. When you dare to take risks, you witness passion and persistence. And that's where change happens.
As we've been talking about, Donald Trump is ramping up his claims that the election is rigged against him. At his rallies and on Twitter, he's hammering that message home.
The election is being rigged by corrupt media pushing false allegations and outright lies. The process is rigged. This whole election is being rigged. And remember this, it's a rigged election because you have phony people coming up with phony allegations.
Should point out there's no evidence to support Donald Trump's allegations about a rigged election. Over the weekend, Republican leaders and election officials from both parties tried to counter his claims. It's not the first time that Trump has embraced a conspiracy theory. Some would say it's a culmination. Here's Dana Bash.
It looks to me like a rigged election.
Donald Trump is now hitting this note hard, and his chorus of surrogates singing backup.
They are attempting to rig this election.
If you want me to tell me that I think the election of Philadelphia and Chicago is going to be fair, I would have to be a moron to say that.
There's no question that everything possible is being done to stop Donald Trump.
It's not hard to see why Trump's team is doing this. If he loses, he's laying the groundwork for blaming the political system he ran against since day one. He's also following a familiar pattern, peddling in conspiracy theories that don't have facts to back them up.
Remember, Trump first stepped onto the political stage 5 years ago, pushing the mother of all political conspiracies, questioning whether President Obama was born in America.
If he wasn't
born in this country, it's one of the great scams of
all time.
And as a candidate for president, he's promoted some doozies, like Ted Cruz's father being involved in John Kennedy's assassination.
His father was with Lee Harvey Oswald prior to Oswald's being, shot. I mean, the whole thing is ridiculous. What is this, right prior to his being shot? And nobody even brings it up.
Trump used his famous, many people are saying phrase as a crutch to road test conspiracy theories from the 1990s, like questioning whether Clinton aide and friend Vince Foster really committed suicide. Quote, there are people who continue to bring it up because they think it was absolutely a murder. I don't do that because I don't think it's fair, he said. Now Trump is even throwing out there that Hillary Clinton may be on drugs with zero evidence to prove it.
At the beginning of her last debate, she was all pumped up at the beginning. And at the end, it was like, oh, take me down. She could barely reach her car. So I think we should take a drug test. I'm willing to do it.
Trump's focus on what he calls a rigged system goes beyond unfounded allegations of widespread voter fraud. He also claims the press is in on it.
The corporate media in our country is no longer involved in journalism. They're a political special interest, no different than any lobbyist or other financial entity with a total political agenda, and the agenda is not for you, it's for themselves.
Many Trump supporters, like Edie Hollister, tell us they believe the system is rigged against their candidate. It's why they don't believe sexual assault allegations against Trump.
All of the media that's been holding back on a totally irrelevant issue.
You think it's totally irrelevant?
Totally irrelevant.
How come?
Because it's not the issues. National security, border security, foreign policy, Obamacare, those are the issues.
Some Trump conspiracies echo those seen on conservative sites like Breitbart, whose executive chairman, Steve Bannon, is on leave to help run Trump's campaign. It worked for Trump to rally the base in the primaries, but the general election, to be determined. Dana Bash, CNN, Washington.
Well, there are signs that Trump's claims about a rigged election are resonating with his supporters, setting off talk of rebellion in some crowds. We have a lot to discuss. Joining me, CNN senior political analyst and former presidential advisor David Gergen. Also with us, CNN senior political commentator and former Obama senior advisor David Axelrod. You can find his Axe Files podcast on CNN.com. David Axelrod, this message by Donald Trump, I mean, it certainly appeals to his core supporters, but what does that really do for him at this point? Doesn't he need to expand his base, women voters, young voters, minorities?
Yeah, this has been a dilemma for him for some time. He has a very committed base. When he said, I could shoot someone on Fifth Avenue and I wouldn't lose a vote, he was right that he has a base of followers who will follow him anywhere. But they aren't enough to win an election, and he has had real difficulty expanding beyond it, and he's been his own worst enemy in that regard, and particularly among these college-educated white voters who he seems to be systematically driving away, and among them women most of all. So, all of the things that he's doing now seem designed to reinforce support that he already has, but not to build on it.
David Gergen, I mean, historically, have you ever seen anything like this, a presidential nominee calling the electoral process into question to this degree?
No, we've never had anyone call it into question to this degree. We have had Republican candidates in the last couple of elections. John McCain, most famously, called into question the what Acorn was doing and how it might disrupt, he believed, his election. But this is very, very fundamental. Donald Trump, without evidence, is questioning the very fundamentals of how we elect people. It's not just one organization. He's saying the whole thing is fixed, and it's a fix between the media and Democratic Party. And I think what he's doing, Anderson, is preparing people for a loss.
Right.
And then he can say, you know, I didn't lose. The system was rigged.
Which goes against, I mean, yeah, how every candidate, David Axelrod, who's lost, I mean, generally says, you know what, okay, I lost, and I support my opponent. You know, we're now all in this together. We got to come together as a country. Donald Trump said he would do that, I think, during the first debate. But you wonder what his message, if he loses, is going to be.
Listen, I look at Donald Trump and I see a guy who defines the world in terms of winners and losers. And he clearly sees himself on one side of that column. He is not someone who will accept a loss as legitimate. We saw this during the primary. After he lost the Iowa caucuses, he very quickly started talking about the fact that it was fixed, that it was rigged. And so he is laying the groundwork for a loss. I don't know whether it's a strategic decision or whether it's emotionally necessary for him, but the result of it is that we're going to have a very ugly aftermath if he doesn't win this election, because a large number of voters who supported him are going to believe what he's saying, and they're not going to accept the result. And I think that's very frightening for our democracy.
David Gergen, Paul Ryan spoke out about this weekend saying, quote, our democracy relies on the confidence in election results. Could they not be just reckless, but actually dangerous?
Yeah, no, I think they could be. And give credit to Mike Pence for also saying we're going to accept the results of this election, and in contradiction to Trump's suggestions here. But look, I Trump is calling for observers to be at the polling booth. And we already know some of those observers are basically saying we're going to engage in racial profiling. We believe that basically blacks and minorities fix elections. They come out and vote when they shouldn't. And they're going to be Muslims are going to show up. And basically, they're suggesting, some of them have been public print suggesting they may start harassing voters. They may start delaying the process. It could throw real monkey wrenches into this. But Anderson, there's also something that's very profound here. The Republican Party, for a variety of reasons, has taken it. Conservatives argue frequently now that the system is fixed, that essentially in inner cities in particular, there's massive amounts of fraud. The evidence does not support massive amounts of fraud. Professor Loyola has studied elections between 2000 and 2014. There were only 35 credible cases of minor fraud, and they never threw any election. But when you start going down this road, you undermine the belief of voters that the election is fair. And once that happens, the person who wins is branded as illegitimate. And that's what they're trying to do to Hillary Clinton now, is to make her illegitimate. And frankly, it is encouraging people, I think, or let's not, I don't want to say encourage. There are people who are following Trump who now believe that she belongs in jail, not in the White House, and maybe somebody ought to take her out. You hear those kind of loose comments, and they're frightening.
Yeah. David Axelrod, David Gergen, guys, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Coming up, does Melania Trump also think the election is rigged? Today I asked her about that and about her husband's comments and all the women who have come forward to say he touched them inappropriately. Her thoughts next. Well, today I sat down with Melania Trump for her first interview since the tape emerged of her husband bragging in 2005, the same year they got married, that he could kiss and grope women because he's a celebrity. As you know, at least 9 women have come forward to say he did just that. Donald Trump says they are liars and has said about some of them that they aren't sexually attractive enough for him to be interested in. How does Melania Trump feel about all of it? I asked her.
It was 10 days ago that Access Hollywood released that tape. I'm wondering, when you first saw it, when you first heard it, what did you think?
I said to my husband that, you know, the language is inappropriate. It's not acceptable. And I was surprised, because that is not the man that I know. And as you can see from the tape, the cameras were not on. It was only a mic. And I wonder if they even knew that the mic was on, because they were kind of a boy talk, and he was lead on, like egg on, from the host to say dirty and bad stuff.
You feel the host, Billy Bush, was sort of egging him on?
Yes, yes.
Is that language you had heard him use before?
No, that's why I was surprised, because I said, like, I don't know that person that would talk that way, and that he would say that kind of a stuff in private. I heard many different stuff, boys talk. The boys, that the way they talk when they grow up and they wanna sometimes show each other, oh, this and that, and talking about the girls. I was surprised, of course.
Michelle Obama, who you, I know, have spoken positively of in the past, she said last week about what your husband said on that tape. She said, this was not just a lewd conversation. This wasn't just locker room banter. This was a powerful individual speaking freely and openly about sexually predatory behavior and actually bragging about kissing and groping women. In terms of what he actually said on the tape, not saying he did it, but what he said, the behavior he described to you, is that sexual assault?
No, that's not a sexual assault. He didn't say he did it. And I see many, many women coming to him and giving phone numbers and, want to work for him or inappropriate stuff from women. And they know he's married.
So you've seen that?
Oh, yes, of course. It was in front of me.
In front of you?
In front of me. And I said, like, why you need to give your number to my husband? I'm very strong. People, they don't really know me. People think and talk about me oh, Melania, oh, poor Melania. Don't feel sorry for me. Don't feel sorry for me. I can handle everything.
I know you want your voice to be heard on this. So a number of women have come forward. They've made allegations against your husband. Some of them go back more than 30 years. He has said they're lying. Do you believe him?
I believe my husband. This was all organized from the opposition. And with the details that they go, did they ever check the background of these women? They don't have any facts, and even the story that came out in People magazine, the writer, that she said that my husband took her to the room and started kissing her, she wrote in the same story about me that she saw me on Fifth Avenue and I said to her, Natasha, we don't see you anymore. I was never friend with her. I would not recognize her.
That never happened?
Never happened. That's why I sent them the letter, because it discredited the story.
Right, your lawyer has sent a letter to People magazine saying they have to retract.
Yes, because it was not true. So how we could believe her? That never happened. I was never friend with her. I saw her, she interviewed us twice. She came to the wedding and for that story. That's it. I would not recognize her on the street or ask her why we don't see her anymore. So that was another thing, like, you know, people come out saying lies and not true stuff.
We're 3 weeks to the election. If you could let the American people know one thing about your husband, what would it be? Because right now, the latest polls show, I think, more than 60% of people believe your husband made some sort of unwanted advance. What do you want those people to know? What would you say to them?
That my husband is kind and he's a gentleman, and he would never do that. That everything was organized and put together to hurt him, to hurt his candidacy.
Organized by the opposition?
By opposition, yes.
Media Clintons,
yes.
You think they're working together?
Yes, of course.
Well, the two men heard speaking on that now infamous Access Hollywood tape, one is running for president, the other got fired. Billy Bush is officially leaving NBC in the Today Show. He was suspended right after the tape came out, and after several days of negotiations, the exit deal is done. His spokesman wouldn't comment on the terms of the deal.
Thank you. Are you ready to be a soapstar?
Just ahead, inside the battle to retake Mosul from ISIS, Nick Payne-Walsh is with Iraqi and Kurdish forces on the front lines.